privilege to finish the day. I think that you are tired. So, my talk is about damage mechanics, and I will try to explain in 40 minutes the basic ingredients of gradient damage model. So, a lot of my time will be spent to explain the construction of this type of model. And I will try to obtain some properties of this type of model. I have not the time to explain all the details, why we develop this type of model for fracture. But there is some analogy between this model and the model presented by Gian Pietro this morning. Here, it's damage. I will explain what is damage. And the model of Gian Pietro is, in fact, non-local elastic plastic models. But there is, both in the construction, in the property, in the concept to obtain this property, very strong similitude. So probably an interesting task should be to improve this analogy, and I am sure that in the future, if you agree with that, we will have the opportunity to do that. So, I think that we have the same type of view of the life and of the science. And so, I think that this type of model is very interesting, and probably combine both models, those of Gian Pietro and this one, should furnish very interesting models to combine ductile and brittle fracture. So it's an interesting task for them. And I am sure that we are ready to do that. So it's a joint work with Kim Pham, is a very good student, which is in PhD now with Mark Geers in Eindhoven. He has made his PhD with me in Paris 6. And Corrado Morini comes from La Sapienza, and he's maître of conference in Paris 6 also, and I have moved in École Polytechnique, and I am in École Polytechnique since two years. So my story with damage is a very long story, because the first paper was written in 81, so 30 years ago, and the principal ingredients to model damage are made in the 80s, in fact. So more recently, we develop another kind of model by introducing, in fact, non-local terms, because we have in mind to use this type of model for fracture. So I will not present the how we can use this type of model for fracture, but if you are interested by that, you can, for instance, write some books or some paper, and so all that is explained in this type of works. So I simply explain basic ingredients. So first, the stress strain response of brittle material. So the stress in terms of the strain, if you prescribe a monotoning evolution of the strain, you observe for material like concrete such a response. First, a linear response, and then non-linear response, sometimes with an increasing of the stress, sometimes with a decreasing of the strength. Depends in tension you find that, in compression you find that, for instance. So the difference between damage and plasticity is seen when you make an unloading. And so if I unload, if I decrease the strain, in my case, I will see a change of the slope here, so a change of the stiffness. That means, and there is no residual strain in Gianpietro, there is the slope is the same in the, during the loading, and there is a residual strain. So the change, the difference between the two types of models is here. So we have a change of the stiffness here. What is important also is that the fact that this curve is decreasing or increasing. So we call that softening effect, this one hardening effect. And in of course, it's a one-dimensional response. So we can define the concept of softening or hardening more for a three-dimensional body by considering the following. You see that here, in fact, the damage evolves. That means damage means there is a decreasing of the stiffness. So damage evolves. When damage evolves, the critical stress is decreasing in that case, and is increasing in this case. So we can define, in fact, in several dimensions, the concept of hardening or softening by considering in the space of the stress if the domain of elasticity is growing, hardening, or decreasing, softening. So it's not uniquely a one-dimensional property, it's a three-dimensional property. So basic ingredients is a change of the stiffness when some critical value of the strain or the stress is reached. So we have to define how, to precise how this evolution of the damage evolves to precise the evolution of the critical stress or the critical strain. So in several dimensions, in three dimensions if you want, you were in the following situation. I assume that for a given, so first I will consider only damage which can be represented by a scalar variable. That means I introduce an internal variable, alpha, which is a scalar. And by choosing the units, by shifting the value of this variable, I can assume that alpha is equal to zero when the material is sound and is completely damaged in the sense that there is no more stiffness when alpha reaches a critical value alpha m. So it's a scalar. And for a given alpha, I assume that the behavior is purely elastic. That means I have a relation between the stress and the strain, which with a potential, which is elastic potential. In the sequel, I will consider only quadratic potential. Phi must be a quadratic function of epsilon. So the stress, we have here the stress-strain relation, and to take into account that the fact that the stiffness decreases, we have only to precise that the Young modulus will decrease when alpha is increasing, but we have also to define how alpha evolves. So in several dimensions, that consists to say that in the space of the strain, or in the space of the stress, there exists an elastic domain such that as long as the damage, the strain remains inside this domain, alpha does not evolve. And so we have to precise what is the shape of this domain. So there is obviously an infinite number of choices, and it's turned out that if we introduce this postulate, which is due to Drucker and Ilyushin, in fact, it's the Ilyushin postulate, which says that we require that the strain work along a cycle in the space of strain must be positive. That means that this quantity is in fact the energy that I give to the volume element, it must be non-negative in any cycle in strain. So it's a postulate. If I use that, very strong result, which is proved here, is that in fact this is possible only if this domain is given by this criterion. This criterion says that if you see here minus the derivative of the elastic energy with respect to the damage parameter. In fact, this quantity is the elastic energy release weight, the release of elastic energy to the damage growth. And this postulate says that this quantity, when this quantity reaches a critical value, which can depend on the damage parameter, then damage can evolve. So, no, only of alpha. Yeah. The key point in this proof, here you have only a function of alpha. Its a derivative is not important. In fact, which is interesting is the primitive of that. Yeah. No, the critical point, in fact, the shape of this domain is given by that. Like Griffith's criterion, if you want. Okay? And here you have a function of alpha. But by changing the variable alpha, you can consider that this, by a change of variable, you can consider that this quantity is a constant, if you want. So the key point is that this shape is given by this derivative, okay? And this is the key point to obtain a variational formulation of the problem of damage. Without that, I can't finish my talk. So, and what is interesting is due to that. So it's a physical principle to justify this type of model. So the proof is not difficult. You can find a rigorous proof inside. So we can use this type of model. Maybe it's not exactly, I have simplified, sorry, Michel, I have simplified the behavior of elastomers, but in fact, it's the same type of behavior than those given, presented by Michel Roy, except that you have no loops here. I consider that loading and unloading are reversible. So, but we can use this type of model to represent the behavior of elastomer. Simply, all the behavior is non-linear, both in elastic regime and in damage regime. And for concrete, for instance, you have to introduce a key point of concrete that it has a behavior completely different in tension and in compression. And to do that, you have to take into account, in fact, in the expression of the elastic energy in terms of alpha, the sign of epsilon, in fact. And so you will obtain automatically a domain in the space of stress or in strain completely different in tension and in compression. So, but I will only consider simplest model. So, I have omitted one thing, is this one. Okay. So, the complete set of equation of the model is given here, the stress-strain relation, the irreversibility condition of damage. So there is three items: irreversibility, a yield criterion, and a consistency relation, which is nothing but an energy balance, in fact. So the irreversibility, damage can only increase, and the criterion of evolution. And here, this equation says that the damage evolves only when you have an equality here. But in fact, it's also a balanced energy, because we obtain this fundamental result, which is a consequence of what is above. Is that if you, I consider the strain work along any path, so I start from the undamaged state of the material with epsilon is equal to zero. I prescribe a strain path and I calculate the strain work. With this model, this strain work is path independent, and so it becomes a function of the state. So it depends only on epsilon and alpha. And we interpret that as the sum of two terms, the elastic energy plus W of alpha, which is the primitive of the previous one, which is dissipated energy. So the strain work is the sum of the elastic energy plus the dissipated energy, which is a function only of alpha. And you can interpret that in this diagram stress strain. So it's very important for the sequel, all that, because now, if I consider an evolution problem for a structure, so I have to add to that, so I have to find the evolution of the displacement and of the damage parameter inside the body for a given loading history and initial condition. So I have simply to add equilibrium equation. And in fact, it turns out, without any additional assumption, that equilibrium plus evolution is equivalent to this variational inequality here, where appears here the total energy of the body. So here is the elastic energy, here is the potential of the prescribed forces, and here is the dissipated energy. So this energy, which depends on U and alpha, you take the derivative with respect to U and alpha, and you take the derivative at this point at time t, and in the direction given by V minus U dot of t, it's the rate of the displacement, beta minus alpha dot of t, the rate of the damage, and this quantity must be positive for any admissible V beta. V admissible means that it has to satisfy boundary condition, and beta, because beta, you see that beta is like alpha dot, so beta must be positive. And so, if you solve this inequality, you recover equilibrium, hence the previous evolution law. Yeah. U dot and V and U dot satisfy the same boundary condition, of course. For here, yes, and for here, no. Beta is positive only. Okay. Yeah. Is there a problem? Is that no? Okay. So the next step is to analyze the qualitative property of this type of evolution problem. And then the character for hardening or softening of the behavior is essential. In fact, we can prove, I have not the time to prove that. But if the behavior is with hardening, you have uniqueness, you have essentially existence, and so on. All is good. With softening, all is bad. That means that you have either no solution because the loading is too high, or an infinite number of solutions. You can obtain failures. You can develop thin, so in fact, domain of alpha with zero volume, and which cut the body in two parts. So you can break the body without any dissipation infarct. So it's due to this type of, so it's due to softening and to the fact that we use a local model of damage. And with numerics, you have the same type of problem. Mesh dependence, algorithm dependence of all of that. That means that, in fact, we have to change the model. And the idea is the same than that of Gian Pietro, is to add non-local terms. But in the construction, I start from the end. So simply I say, okay, I will add non-local terms, but I assume that the strain work, the general definition of strain work, is the same as before, plus one term here. In fact, we can refine this type of argument. In fact, you see that, in fact, so I consider only quadratic dependence on of W respect to epsilon. So, in fact, you are like in linear elasticity, you develop this potential with respect to epsilon and gradient of alpha up to the quadratic terms. So, you have here a constant term in terms of gradient alpha, here a quadratic term, what is missing is a linear term. Here you have a quadratic term in epsilon, what is missing is a linear term in epsilon, and what is missing is a quadratic term which corresponds to epsilon times gradient alpha. But if the material is isotropic, all this, so the linear term in gradient alpha, the quadratic term with gradient alpha and epsilon disappears. So in fact, the unique assumption is that I disappear the terms which is linear in the epsilon, which correspond to, in fact, pre-stress in the body. So one way to introduce residual strain or residual stress is to reintroduce here, in particular, a linear term in epsilon. So I do not that. So I consider this form of the strain work. Obviously, this term has to be positive, otherwise I don't regularize the problem. And so by dimensional consideration, you see that, in fact, here, this coefficient, if alpha has no dimension, has the dimension of the Young modulus times length squared. And you can interpret this function of alpha as a material characteristic function. So I change the form of the strain work, and I simply introduce that in the form of the total energy of the body, and I claim that the new evolution problem is the same than before formally. That means I have to find ut and alpha t such that this inequality remains true for any admissible V and beta. Okay? Obviously, beta is another space because you have introduced gradient, so. But that is for mathematicians. For me, I claim that I have an evolution law for the damage which is constructed by analogy with damage, local damage law. And I use that. First of all, another remark is that, in fact, damage parameter has no physical meaning at this stage because I can't just change this variable, make a change of variable. And so, so I start from this. So I have changed the notation. So alpha is now capital D, okay? Because I will change that. So there is a constant term here, a quadratic term in terms of the gradient of D, and a quadratic term in terms of epsilon. and I consider only one D. All before all is valid in any dimension, yes. And I could continue in any dimension, but to simplify the presentation, I shift in one dimension. So you can choose the variable in such a manner, for instance, that this function becomes a constant. Or you can choose the variable in such a manner that this function becomes linear in the new damage variable. And I make this choice because we can interpret easily the two functions E of alpha and L of alpha with this form of W. So now in the model, in one dimension, you have two functions, L of alpha, E of alpha, one constant here, W1, and the range where alpha has to evolve, okay? And so to precise the character of damage, you simply add some inequality for this, so I omit one inequality, which is important, is that L of alpha is positive. And so for E of is damage is the Young modulus in terms of the damage variable, and here is the compliance function 1 over E. So E must be positive until there is no more stiffness. E must be decreasing, and you add this inequality. This inequality is important in order that you have, in fact, you can prescribe an increasing epsilon, which is increasing in time. So if you have not this inequality, you have such a behavior with the stack back here, so it's not good for. So I prescribe that we have the inequality E second, which is positive, in order to have no stack back. So, and what is important is that here, the hardening behavior, the fact that in the space of stress, the domain of elasticity is increasing, is simply a property of the second derivative of the compliance. So if S second is negative, we have hardening, and if F second is positive, we have softening. And what is interesting, in fact, obviously, is softening behavior. How many times, Francesco? Okay. So, if I use this, so now I have defined the model, I have introduced the evolution problem, I interpret the evolution problem now locally. So that means that I make the integration by parts and so on. So I recover in one dimension. So I consider a bar intention is the same problem as that of Gian Pietro with a hard device. So I prescribe the displacement here, and T is simply the value of the overall strain, in fact, here. And so equilibrium says that, so I obtain equilibrium obviously, and the equilibrium says that sigma is only a function of T, and the new yield criterion is non-local, obviously, so you recover here, with a change of notation, in fact, in terms of the stress, the energy release weight criterion, the local terms as before, plus non-local terms due to the gradient of damage. So, and because L is a function of alpha, you have second derivative of D respect to X and first derivative of D respect to X. So you have to satisfy this inequality everywhere in the body, so non-local because of second derivative of alpha. And you obtain also, if you say that there is no boundary condition for the damage, you obtain natural boundary condition for damage. So alpha prime in zero must be negative, you obtain inequality, in fact. and the converse inequality at the other end. And obviously, you obtain also a consistency equation. That means that you have alpha dot, which is not zero, only if you have equality here. And it's the same at the boundary. So you can interpret this type of model locally simply by the variational principle. What happens? But it happens that in the case of softening, in the case of hardening, all is good. In the case of softening, the behavior of this type of model depends on the size of the body. In fact, we have size effects. In particular, if I try to solve this problem when the length of the bar is large enough, then I can obtain an infinite number of solutions to this problem. I have not the time to explain how we can obtain this family of solutions, but we can obtain an infinite number of solutions. That means that if I add non-local terms, uniqueness is not ensured. So we have to introduce another criterion to select the good solution. In particular, one solution, which is evident in which is obvious in this problem, is the homogeneous solution. In fact, the question, Gianpietro, no. No. You can disturb me, it's not the problem. So, a trivial solution is the homogeneous solution. Homogeneous solution means that alpha and u prime depends only on t, not on x. Obviously, it does not depend on the size of the body, and this solution does not depend on the introduction of these non-local terms. So, I have always the uniform solution as possible solution. One fundamental question is, is this solution stable? Can I observe, for instance, the homogeneous solution? So I introduce simply this diagram is not important. So I introduce simply the stability criterion. I give the main result for the stability of the homogeneous homogeneous response. So the idea of stability is very simple. Always the same. I have an energy function here, and I introduce a kind of local minimum principle, except that I have to take into account the irreversibility of damage. So I claim that, and it's only a directional stability in fact. So I consider a state of the body, fields u and alpha, a direction, v and beta admissible. So v has to satisfy zero boundary condition for the displacement, and beta must be positive in order that the new fields that I investigate is more with the damage which is more important than that of I test the stability. So I only consider beta positive here. And I claim that this state is stable if I can find h for given v and beta, h for h sufficient small enough, this inequality. So it's a local minimum, but only for greater damage, in fact. So if I use that for test the stability of the homogeneous response, I first consider an expansion of p of this term with respect to h. So the first order term here plus the second order term plus eventually the third terms and so on. It turns out that for homogeneous response, this term is zero. And so the stability of the homogeneous state depends on the sign of this quantity. And this quantity, which is the second derivative with respect to u and alpha, is given by that. Where appears here, so the state is homogeneous, so you have constant here, which depends on the state, obviously. So it's L of alpha t squared here, it's E of alpha t here, and so on. You have constant here. And you have to study the sign of this quadratic form in terms of beta and v. But only for v admissible and beta positive. And so it's equivalent that to study, so sorry, you can change the form of the second derivative to, and you remark that there is two positive terms here, because here is positive, and here you have a negative term because of softening. With hardening, this term is positive. And so all is positive, all is okay, all is stable. With softening, this term is negative. And so you have to compare the sum of the two terms with this one. And you see that non-local terms has a regularization, so give a stability because it appears as a positive terms. And so you have to study this ratio. And if this ratio is greater than one, you have stability. If less than one, you have instability. You can compute in one dimension this this minimum of the Rayleigh ratio. In several dimensions, the principle is the same, except that we cannot compute by hand the minimum. I give you the result. In fact, there is a lot of computation. It's not trivial because you have to consider the minimization with respect to positive, so with a constraint here. And you find, so maybe, so the final form is, in fact, all depends on the length of the bar. If the length of the bar is small enough, the homogeneous state is stable. If it's large enough, it's unstable. And the critical length of the bar depends on the state. So depends, T is the strain, in fact, and it depends on all the constant of the model. And so you have a size effect if the size of the bar is less than this quantity, where appears this function here, which is characteristic of non-local term. So if L is less than that length, so you have stability of the homogeneous response. And so you can use that. You can draw, for instance, for a family of model, you can draw the dependence on the critical length of the bar with respect to the strain that you prescribe to the bar. And for instance, for one family of model, you obtain that if the strain is small, it's less than the critical, so that corresponds to the critical strain where there is no damage. Obviously, when you are only an elastic response, the elastic response is stable. Obviously, it's the same type of argument. When epsilon is greater than epsilon c, you see that, so this, if the length of the bar is less than that, you have stability, otherwise no stability. And the dependence on of L, the critical length in epsilon, depends on the model. Here, this function is decreasing, here is constant, here is increasing, depends on the model. And you see that you can use, remark that the stress-strain relation does not depend on the non-local terms. But the stability obviously depends on the non-local terms. So this, if you are able to measure when you are in stability of the elastic response, you have an information on the non-local term. So you can measure the non-local, the critical, the internal length, and this additional function here. So maybe I have to finish. Okay. So thank you for your attention.
No, maybe it's a question.